Good morning, everybody. I hope that everybody had a good breakfast this morning, brunch this morning, and that, mixed with a wonderful speaker, a beautiful day, a really warm atmosphere here, I think is really going to be special for us this morning. I'd like to begin with a blessing. And if you hear my blessing, I think you'll understand why I'm starting with this, perhaps. But I think as we gather, every time we gather, there are many things that we are grateful for. And these are the things that I'm particularly grateful for. Holy One of Blessing, you have taught us that every human being is created in your image, and that therefore we are called upon to protect the vulnerable and love the stranger, to house the homeless and feed the hungry, and to work for a world of peace. Let us realize these values wherever we bring our influence, in our synagogue community, anywhere we go in our beloved country, perhaps even in the land of Israel, in all the world. As citizens of the United States, we are blessed with freedoms unequaled in the history, for example, the Jewish people. Let us honor and use those freedoms of speech and assembly, a freedom of consent and a freedom of dissent that the founders gave to us. Let us use those powers wisely. Let us continue to pray for the welfare of our nation at good times and at difficult occasions. May God guide the hand and thoughts of our leaders and officials so that they perform good and honorable deeds in order to maintain our nation as a place we so dearly love. Let us all work to realize a nation in which there is truly liberty and justice for all. Good morning. Thank you. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to the Liesl M. Blockstein Memorial Lecture. We are pleased to offer this program every year. And when I say we, I'm talking about Jewish Social Services and the Temple Beth El, who many years ago helped to establish this particular occasion. This occasion, of course, is here in memory of Liesl M. Blockstein, a beloved member of the Beth El community and someone who is deeply involved in Jewish social services. Her husband, Bill, also of blessed memory, established this lecture and scholarship fund to celebrate the achievements of Wisconsin women in politics, public service, religion, arts, literature, and music, or in other areas of endeavor. We are pleased to have this morning with us two, Marge and Deb Sutman, who are special friends of Bill and the Blockstein family, so we're so pleased to have you both here. Thank you for being here. Beneficiaries of the Blockstein Fund also include women Wisconsin residents who are admitted to an accredited course of study at the Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion in the areas of rabbinic study, cantorial study, Jewish education, and Jewish communal service. And if you may or may not know this, but we currently have a student who is a second year rabbinic student at Hebrew Union College in New York, who is a Madison native, I believe. Sarah Berman is her name, and most of you know her. She is a recipient and beneficiary of monies from this fund. And so we are pleased to enable women who are Wisconsin residents to be enabled to study for these important Jewish communal fields. This lecture, as I mentioned before, is a program jointly sponsored by Temple Beth El and Jewish Social Service. And then to tell you a little bit about JSS and to introduce our speaker, I now would like to introduce Don Bernay, who is the director of the Jewish Social Services here in Madison.
Allowing me to be here, and thank you to the Blockstein family and friends for this program. It's a wonderful program, and I've been in my position at Jewish Social Services for a little over a year, and just as I'm learning about things that we've done in the past, and I learn more about Liesl, I'm just completely in awe of everything she's done with government, with Jewish social services, in so many different ways that she touched the lives of people in Madison. And I know that one of the things that she was involved with was some of the refugee resettlement that we did way, well, before I was even living in Madison, with the resettlement of the Soviet Jews in Madison. And so knowing that, I thought that would be a good opportunity to just spend a minute to talk a little bit about what's going on with refugee resettlement in Madison right now. Many of you are aware that Jewish Social Services in the last 7 weeks have resettled 3 families here in Madison. We have 3 Syrian families that are here. They have little kids that range in age from 2 to 8. The 5-year-old and 8-year-old started school a week after they arrived in Madison, which also, the day they arrived in Madison, happened to be the day of the inauguration, which was definitely an interesting experience for all of us. All of the men are now started work last week, have jobs. One of the women has a job, and they're working really hard. I mean, that was the thing. Their big thing was to be safe and to protect their families. And that's really why they're here. And that's why it is so important for Jewish Social Services and the broader community to work on this. And I am so appreciative of Temple Bethel and the Jewish Congregations for Social Justice and Open Doors for Refugees and all of the other organizations that we are working very closely with to do this work that we're doing. You all know that the executive order that was signed just a couple of weeks ago, actually the afternoon that I came to Temple Bethel that evening to speak at the Sisterhood Shabbat, that has been put aside for now, but we don't know what's going to happen. It may go before the Supreme Court, or what's even more likely is that there's going to be a new executive order that's put into place that maybe will pass muster. And so we're just in a wait and see mode right now. We have 3 families in the pipeline, 2 from Syria, 1 from Eritrea, that have been matched with Jewish Social Services to come to Madison. And we're really hopeful that they can get their visas and they can get their plane tickets and they will be able to come here to Madison. We do have a listserv that we're sending information out about once a week. I try not to inundate people, and it sort of gives an update and says what we need. So this week, for example, we asked for a men's bicycle and a bike lock and a light, that sort of thing. And people have been really responsive, and that's been great. So if you're interested in getting on our listserv, you can go to our website at jssmadison.org, and you can then also be getting our weekly updates. But again, I want to thank everyone in the community, because we're a tiny agency. We're doing refugee resettlement. We're doing immigration legal services. We have all of our fabulous senior programming. We have Ohio. We have the Levy series that we're really, really proud of. We do case management for seniors and for anyone who needs help. And we don't charge a fee for pretty much anything that we do. And again, I'm really grateful to the community, because there's no way we could do that without your help. I'm also really appreciative, besides social services, just having arts in the community. And I feel very privileged to be able to now introduce our featured speaker, Jennifer, who I knew a little bit a long time ago. Both of us had 15-year-olds who were in the same preschool class together. So for me, I will always think of her as the mom I sat next to watching the 4-year-olds run around the soccer field. Jennifer Uphoff Gray is the artistic director of Forward Theater Company, where she directed 4,000 Miles, Mr. Burns, a post-electric play, Silent Sky, Vanya and Sonia and Masha and Spike, From Up Here, or Sons of the Prophet, Good People, 44 Plays for 44 Presidents, 1,000 Words, Profound Horror Convention, Moonlight and Magnolias, In the Next Room, Why Torture is Wrong, and The People Who Love Them, and All About Eve. Regionally, She has directed for Madison Rep and Milwaukee Shakespeare. Also, National Tour of Copenhagen and Associate Director on Broadway of Copenhagen, Cabaret, The Blue Room starring Nicole Kidman, and the like. Jen grew up in the Madison area, holds a degree in dramatic literature and stage history from Harvard College, and with her husband Peter is raising her family on Madison's west side. She's the daughter-in-law of Betty and Walter Gray, our members here at Temple Bethel. Welcome, Jennifer.
How's that? Can you all hear me well?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm a director, so communication's important to me. If you can't hear me, feel free to shout out, and I will move closer to the mic. Thank you all so much for inviting me to join you this morning. It's just absolutely an honor to take part in a lecture series that has such an impressive history and such inspiration behind it. I'm going to do my best to honor that tradition that you have established this morning. I'll start by saying normally when I'm asked to speak publicly, I focus pretty exclusively on the accomplishments and the future plans of Forward Theater Company. This invitation specifically asked me to take a more personal approach and think about how my own background has influenced my career choices and how it led to the work that I now do with Forward, both on stage and out in the community. That kind of introspection doesn't always come very easily to me, but as I've been preparing for this talk, I have to say I found myself surprised by the clear line that I can draw from my upbringing to the present. As many of you know, and as I was just introduced, I was born here in Madison into a, let's say, politically engaged family. My parents met here, working on Eugene McCarthy's campaign. And while my dad was Madison-born, and my mother a transplant from New York, who came here for college, they turned out to have family friends in common, because they'd both grown up in very activist families. My father was the son of Midwestern Quaker socialists, and my mother the daughter of East Coast Jewish Democratic socialists. So it was a match made in heaven. So I grew up surrounded by family members who imparted really one very clear value above everything else, and that is that we each have a responsibility to make the world a better place for others. I'm pretty sure I was taken to my first open hearing at the Capitol building when I was, 3 weeks old? two weeks old, I'm sorry. I do remember handing out matchbooks for Bob Castemeyer at the Labor Temple on Labor Day, age three. And by the time I got to high school, I became famous or infamous and frequently mocked by my classmates because I would wear buttons to school every day, usually a different one every day, with some political or social cause espoused. It's interesting because I was really pretty shy, but I felt so strongly about the issues that those buttons represented, and I think that kind of got me comfortable with receiving attention, be it positive or negative. I should say that my mother and father were both feminists, and they made it clear to me that being female was not going to be a hindrance in my life. They each set remarkable examples through their careers working for a long list of social nonprofits and political causes. And I grew up next door to my father's parents. My paternal grandmother, who I called Annie, was a major role model for me. In a lot of ways, she sort of seemed the ultimate farmer's wife. She taught me how to sew and garden and cook canned food, entertain for a crowd. But at the same time, she was the co-author of several books. She published the newsletter for my grandfather's nonprofit organization. She organized conferences that were attended by hundreds of people. And when I was an adult, I found out even more about her background. She was an organizer for the North Dakota Farmers Union in the 1930s as a young single woman. In the 40s, she ran for Congress on a socialist ticket here in Madison. And my favorite, she actually wrote a few plays, which I found out when she was in her 90s, she shared this with me. My maternal grandmother lived farther away in New York, but like Annie, my Bubba was a huge influence in my life. She was also a depression baby and had a long career as an elementary school teacher, She was deeply involved in the workman's circle in New York, and she was an activist in peace movements. She was a founding member of the Democratic Socialists of America. And so I had this incredible mother and these two amazing grandmothers who really brought me up with both a sense of nurturing and taking care of your family and your friends and your community, and also these really amazing accomplishments that were not to be expected for women of their generation. So being born in the 1970s, the early 1970s, I didn't personally have to fight in the worst of the gender wars, but it was very clear to me that I was the beneficiary of the work that was done by my mother and my grandmothers, so that I would have things easier than they did. And my father and grandfathers too, they saw no more limits on my potential than my brothers. And all of that was an amazing gift for me growing up. So as I finished high school, theater was a great passion of mine, but I had absolutely no intention of pursuing it professionally. It was very clear to me that I was going to go to law school, become a civil rights attorney, and be Wisconsin's first female senator. Very happy that it's Tammy Baldwin. But honestly, my high school yearbook, that's what it says I'm going to go and do. And despite our lower middle class economic status, you know, families don't get rich when everybody works for nonprofits. I applied to Harvard College and was fortunate enough to be accepted. And thanks to an incredibly generous financial aid package and my parents' willingness to take out some pretty hefty student loans, I was able to attend. And being at Harvard was a pretty life-altering experience for me, and not just because I met my husband Peter there, and so my three children here today wouldn't exist if I had not gone there. But it's also because it's where I discovered directing and realized that my passion for theater wasn't just a hobby, it was a calling for me. And I can say that there are pros and cons, of course, to attending college in a pretty rarefied atmosphere, if I can describe it that way. But I have to say my overall experience at Harvard can be summed up in two really clear messages that the college conveyed. And the first was that I could do anything I chose to do. And the second is that with the privilege that was afforded me by that education came great responsibility. And I believe me, I know I sound like I'm quoting Spider-Man. but that really was the takeaway. And being a Harvard student actually reinforced for me the values that my family brought me up with, that we have a responsibility to make the world better. I do want to mention one other really formative experience that I had during my Harvard years. I had the great good fortune to have as a mentor there Dr. Jean Newland, who ran the Harvard Theater Collection, and she oversaw my completion of a special degree in dramatic literature and stage history. They didn't actually offer that as a whole, you know, typical program. I was like, I'm going to do an independent study major, because why wouldn't I? And Jean guided me not only in the creation of that major, but particularly in my research into the history of the WPA's Federal Theater Program during the Great Depression. And those studies had an amazing impact on me and my view of the role of the arts in our country and in our society. And they certainly influenced the founding of Forward Theater here in Madison. And I'll talk more about that in a little bit. But after graduation, I moved with my husband to New York City to seek freelance work as a director. No question, the professional theater world in the 1990s was predominantly male, particularly when it came to directors, but I wasn't approaching my work through the lens of gender, and so both my family and my education helped me feel empowered to take on whatever I wanted to, so I went out and did it. I found classes to take, colleagues with whom I could create work in little off Broadway theaters, and to my everlasting gratitude, I had a few male directors as very close mentors, and they never seemed to think that my gender was going to hold me back from a successful career. So it just wasn't a big part of my career there. I just went out and did the work. As the assistant director on a number of Broadway shows under these mentors, I learned by observing their craft. I tried to soak up like a sponge the lessons from the work of the talented artists around me, the actors and the designers and the technicians. And I started to hone an understanding of what kind of work I wanted to do on my own. And this went on for about a decade. I got to work on some really high-profile projects. I got to collaborate with incredible artists. I was making a living as a theater director in New York City, which is like finding a needle in a haystack. So I was incredibly fortunate. But as I entered my 30s and the first two of my three children were born, I was starting to question what I was doing. First of all, was New York the right environment to raise my family? It definitely can be in many ways, but there were sacrifices for sure. But the bigger question that I was struggling with came as I stepped even just partway off of the upwards climb that I was making professionally. Spending a little more time with my young children, it left me with more time to think about the work that I had been doing. And it was exciting, and it was rewarding, but for the first time I really started to question whether it was valuable. In other words, was I fulfilling my responsibility to make the world a better place? And don't misunderstand me, I believe the creation of art intrinsically makes the world a better place. This is, there's no question. I agree. But deep down, it was really hard for me to feel that. And it's largely because in New York, in the professional theater world, you have little to no opportunity to interact with your audience at all. Without that engagement, without a sense of dialogue back and forth with the audience, I couldn't tell if the art was having any impact. It felt lonely, it felt sometimes even self-indulgent. And keep in mind, that was in the early years of this century, and so there were two wars going on, the mainstream struggle for LGBTQ rights was gearing up and gaining a lot of momentum, and I was living in a very, very blue city, in a very, very blue state, where it felt like my vote and my voice were just a tiny little drop in a very big bucket, and not very important. So Peter and I, for a variety of reasons, decided to leave New York and build a life for our family back here in Madison. We wanted to be near my family. We wanted good schools and a good quality of life. As, I mean, why are we all here in Madison? That's a big part of it. We wanted to be in an engaged and progressive community, but also, frankly, there was appeal in being in a swing state where our voices and our votes might suddenly have a little more weight to make a difference. And when we left New York, I honestly did not know whether I would continue to work in the theater. I figured I would make a go at a freelance directing career here in the Midwest, but I was also open to changing fields. And in the back of my mind, I had this vision that I might wind up on the staff of some state senator in the Capitol building. And that would have been great. We moved here in 2005. I don't think I ever saw my mother happier than when I moved home with her two grandsons in tow. Our daughter was born. Peter and I got to enjoy new opportunities for activism. One of my favorite memories is taking our toddlers door to door for the Fair Wisconsin campaign in 2006. And I started to get some directing work here in the Midwest. And things were kind of clicking along. And I was like, all right, we made a good decision here. And then the recession hit. And the Wisconsin professional theater community was immediately feeling the impact of that. In those first 6 months, three professional equity theater companies in southern Wisconsin closed. In 6 months. And that really sent this sort of shockwave through the entire professional theater community. And the amazing Celia Clare, who I know many of you know, who I had just met briefly through a mutual acquaintance, she called a meeting in her home around her kitchen table of local theater professionals so that we could talk about whether there was a way to keep professional theater alive in Madison. And I was lucky enough to be asked to attend. While we didn't know it at the time, Celia and I had very similar background, similar worldviews, though our backgrounds were very different. She was raised in Oklahoma, and then moved to Madison in her teens, but Celia had drilled into her from a very early age the Wisconsin idea. And that meshed pretty darn well with my background, both in social causes, political involvement, the history of the WPA. And the other thing that Celia and I really shared was a foundational belief in the value of family and of community, and frankly, gathering people around a table and feeding them. And is that a gendered thing? Maybe. But in any event, it put us both on the same page pretty darn quickly. we both deep down believed that a theater company that was formed around a commitment to a specific community, around our love for this community and its people, around the shared experience of this community, and with a commitment to listening to and learning from and creating art with this community, that company could and really should make a difference to that community. And we were honestly really freed up when starting Forward by the fact that we were able to start from scratch. We weren't stepping into an existing organization and trying to fix it. We were able to build something from the ground up the way we always wished that things could be. We had nothing to lose in trying something new or in a new way. I really like working collaboratively. All the projects that I've worked on, that was my approach, and I'd never seen a company that had built collaboration and open communication right into its operating structure. But we figured, why not build the company of our dreams if we could figure out a way to make it work? So in founding Forward Theater, we took really seriously the idea that our company would provide a home, not just for the artists that we employ, but also for our audiences. We put the word home in our mission statement, which is really short and sweet. It just says, we are creating a home base for Wisconsin's theater professionals and audiences that expands the cultural and economic life of the greater Madison area. That's the mission. So how do we do that? How do we create a home? Some of these things we knew kind of out of the gate we wanted to do, and some we've learned over these past 8 years that we've been building Forward. First, from the get-go, we have an operating structure that diversifies the input for our decision-making across our staff and our board and our advisory company of artists. You know, I founded the theater, I could have definitely, you know, asserted the need. We need a single leader, I am the boss sort of structure, but that is not remotely how Forward works. We chose the opposite of that. Yes, I lead the company, but with significant mandated input from the rest of the staff, board, and artists. To create that home, we committed to engaging in real dialogue with the audience and actually using what we learned from them in our programming and decision making. We have talkbacks after every performance, as many of you know. I'm looking forward to the talkback after this. That's my favorite part. We do extensive outreach events. We have members of the Forward Theater family in the lobby at every performance. We encourage the audiences to tell us what they think, what they like, what they don't like. You know, it's funny, I left New York in part because I felt no connection to my audience, and I get that in spades here. A typical Forward show is attended by about 4,500 people over the 3-week run. And I feel like I have a personal connection with most of them. And I will run into our patrons at the library, Costco, Hy-Vee, the farmer's market. It seems that everywhere I go, someone will come up and tell me what they liked or didn't about the last production that we did. And I can't tell you how much I value that. So getting back to creating a home, how else do we do that? We hire locally to make sure that theater professionals can continue to live in our area. This fosters a healthy creative class that contributes to our community in countless ways. It's not just that by hiring local artists, they pay taxes and shop locally here, which is really important. It's really that our artists are just as invested as any other citizen in making sure that this is a good place to live for all of us here in the community. So everyone who works with Forward is game and even eager to pitch in and donate their time and talent for the outreach programming that we do around the themes in our plays. Just a few examples over these last 8 seasons. We've raised funds for the Goodman Community Center's job training programs. We distributed 5,000 voter registration forms in partnership with the League of Women Voters. We've performed at benefits for the AIDS Network and Fund for Women. We created a day of free workshops for the Alzheimer's and Dementia Alliance. We've hosted community discussions on school violence and bullying, and so on and so on. We do events like this around every production in our seasons. And that's because we live here. This is our home. I have as much of an interest in a good library system and good schools and good healthcare as anybody else does. And I should also say we take the idea of home and family literally at Forward by feeding everybody. starting from that very first meeting around a kitchen table, food's been a really big part of what we do. And at our monthly advisory company meetings, our annual retreats, our donor appreciation events, our first rehearsals, our tech days, we feed people. And we just really believe that if we nourish our community, they're going to do their best work with us. I don't know of many other organizations, really any other organizations, with our operating structure or this focus on the idea of home and family, but I do know that it's working for us. We're thriving. We employ about 100 artists every season, over 95% of whom live here in southern Wisconsin. We've grown really rapidly. We were a startup in the midst of a big recession. Our opening bank balance was $56 because everyone around that table said, hey, let's pitch in a few bucks so we can get a post office box so we can apply for our 501c3 nonprofit status. So that first ledger shows that $56 as our starting point. Our budget this season is about $750,000, and we've been in the black since we started. A tremendous amount of that credit goes to the community that buys tickets for our plays and donates money and just generally embraces the work that we're trying to do. And admittedly, we live in a very special place here in Madison. What works here might not work everywhere else. That we can continue to program bold, really artistically challenging material and still be so fiscally strong. It's a really rare gift in the arts world, and we don't take that for granted for a minute. To have a smart, engaged, curious, eager audience that wants to be shown new ideas and new ways of storytelling and new points of view is, I'm grateful for it every day. But I do have to believe that our commitment to a community-centered model, to a collaborative model, to open communication that is mandated in our bylaws between the artists and the board and all of the people that work on building our company. I believe that that should work anywhere. It's interesting because getting national recognition for our work has never been one of our goals. In fact, I think that one of the reasons we're succeeding is because we are absolutely just focused on serving our community. But I do harbor hopes that over time, other communities around the country will start to notice the way that we've built forward and how successful it's been, and maybe start to try to replicate that elsewhere. I don't just think that that would make our national arts culture stronger. I think it would make the country stronger in a lot of different ways. And while women are certainly not the only artists and leaders capable of making this kind of change happen, I do know that if we're going to get there, our perspectives and our experiences have to have equal weight at the table or in the rooms where it happens. I'm sorry, I had to do Hamilton. I can't give a theater talk. I can't give a theater talk without referencing Hamilton, right? You know, nationally, female playwrights represent just 22% of professionally produced plays each year. And that number has really not been moving. The percentage of women in leadership positions at professional theaters around the country is around 25%. We can do better. We need to do better. And when we do, not everybody, not just women, is going to do better. It's kind of easy to forget how underrepresented women are in leadership positions at arts organizations because, frankly, here in Madison, women are really the rule and not the exception. It's not just forward to Madison Opera, CTM, APT, Theater Lila, Four Seasons Theater. They're all run by women here in Madison. But if you look even just over at Milwaukee, Milwaukee has 6 fully professional theater companies. 5 are and always have been run by men. And the 6th is Renaissance Theater Works, which was deliberately founded with a mission of telling women's stories and hiring women to do that. So we're in a really nice little bubble here, but it's not the case elsewhere. For now, at Forward, we're planning to keep on doing what we've been doing. We're going to keep on setting an example by providing opportunities to women artists right alongside men, not as any sort of affirmative action, but because these are equally valuable voices. When we programmed our last season, in which all 3 plays happened to have been written by women, it wasn't because we set that as a goal. We just chose what we thought were the best plays for our community for that year, and then looked and said, oh, women wrote all of these. That felt really good. As I move towards concluding, I have to say sometimes my job is hard. I'm not digging ditches for a living. I know that, but my hours can be long, ask my very, very tolerant family. The sense of responsibility is high. There's a lot of people who work for us. We have to raise a lot of money to pay their salaries and to pay the bills. I have thousands of subscribers who want to know, precisely because we have made the effort to listen to them, what we're doing, why we're doing it, where we're going next. And if that sense of responsibility is high, honestly, the pressure that I put on myself is even higher. And believe it or not, I don't actually like a lot of drama in my day-to-day life. And working in the theater, there's sometimes a lot of drama. But I am always aware, every single day, of the fact that getting to work for this company, with these artists, with this audience, for the benefit of this community, is an incredible gift that I never expected to have. And I know now, really deep down, that I and my colleagues are helping to make the world a better place because of the way that we do our work and the way we take that out to connect it with the community. And I don't ever, ever take that for granted. And that gets me through the drama and the long hours and the pressure that I put on myself to do well. And so, I really just want to say thank you to all of you here in this room, but by extension to the broader Madison community that supports our work for giving me that gift that I can create art and still feel that I'm doing what I was raised to do. So thank you. Thank you for giving me this time to talk to you. And now we can do the talk back, which is the part that I like much, much better. Then I know what you would like me to talk about instead of guessing. Yes.
And I have one criticism for forward theater.
Please.
I've been ushering for plays in Madison since 1970.
Thank you.
And it was the Madison Repertory Theater.
Yes.
We were in the Oldwood Village.
Yep.
And to a press house. Yep. And to the Madison Civic Center as they walked into Overture Hall.
Yep.
And as we made the transition to Overture Hall, the ushers were now ushering for everything.
I know.
For anything, whatever. But the play was always a real good ushering meeting because there were always empty seats for the ushers. And the ushers was not willing to watch the play.
Yep.
Well, we did paint the sky. And yep. There were a few empty seats. We were able to find them. But the most recent one was the 4,000 mile thing. There were no empty seats.
I'm really not sorry. But I know it's actually been... thank you for ushering, first of all. Yeah, I know. Thank you. And it cracks me up and makes me really happy the number of people who come to me and say, we used to always usher, but now we just buy tickets because we know we don't get a chance to sit down at a forward show. So thank you. It's a really good problem to have that we run out of seats. Yeah.
Do you have data on how the diversity of the community that is able to come see forward shows by class, by in Madison or out of Madison,
yeah.
To what extent is that sort of thing important and what can forward do to make sure it has a diverse audience?
That is an excellent question. It's very hard. Tickets are generally all purchased through Overture Center and the box office doesn't collect things like economic, status of audience. We can certainly look and say, who's got a Madison address and who's got a Sun Prairie address and who's coming from Milwaukee. I mean, our audience is, big chunk Madison, a lot from around Dane County. We do bring in folks from Milwaukee, sometimes even Chicago, but it's really community-centered, which is kind of what we're going for. But in terms of access, that is something that's incredibly important to us. And we actually do quite a few different things to address that particular topic. One is that, and if anybody in here is an educator or a student or knows people who are educators or students, I'm constantly trying to spread the word. Our preview performance, which is our first public performance in each run, from the get-go, we do $10 tickets for anybody who's a student or an educator, which is a pretty sweet deal. And all you have to do is show your teaching ID or your student ID at the box office and get a $10 ticket. So we've been really pleased to see a really great younger crowd and diverse crowd for that. We work really hard to keep our ticket prices lower, and believe me, I know our top ticket price I think is $47. Believe me, that is not cheap, and I know that. On the other hand, when I think you compare the quality of the work that we're getting to what we would pay for a touring show, I think it's a pretty good deal. You know, we're the only company in town, we pay everybody who works for us, and we pay them at a competitive, you know, union wage. So that's not, it's not free to put that on. But we offer significant numbers of discounted tickets. We give away tons of tickets. The Overture Center has a wonderful community outreach program where they donate tickets to social service organizations. We give a lot of those away. We participate. There's a great Club 10 program that does $10 tickets for things happening at Overture. We do a lot of tickets to that. We partner with a lot of different organizations directly, like the Goodman Community Center. We do 25 to 50 free tickets every show to bring in a group from the Goodman Center and send teaching artists out there. So we're working really hard on it. It's always a hard thing to figure out how to maximize the diversity of our audience, and I mean diversity if all possible, with age, race, gender, economic background, profession, and also pay the bills so that we can keep employing artists. But we take it really seriously, and if anyone ever has ideas of things that we can do better, please share them with us, because it's really one of the main driving things that we talk about as a company as we approach each season. So, thank you.
I have a question. I was interested in the history of the WPA and how government gave some money to the artists to build it together.
Yep.
But I'm wondering, in the current climate and the current era, what are some of the ways that we, as people who don't work professionally, most of us in the theater, how can we ensure that the current government doesn't lose sight of the importance of funding to the arts?
Boy, if I had the answer to that, yeah. I could do a lot of well-paid consulting. Continuing to communicate with our elected representatives is the best possible way. I mean, I'm going to be really honest. Even under this previous administration, which was phenomenally supportive of the arts, the amount of money that comes from the federal, state, and local government to support the arts is almost non-existent. Compared to even just before the recession, it has gone down. I think something like 1.5 or 2% of our budget comes from government support, and that's including national, state, county, and local support. So in a strange way, if it goes away, it doesn't hurt everybody as much as it would have a number of years ago, because there's very little there to begin with. But really, there's kind of two things that I think are most important from an advocacy standpoint. One is just trying to remind the government that the arts have value for our society on a lot of different levels. It is not just the level that I think we all agree, art makes us better human beings. I think everybody agrees to that, but whether or not they believe that we should fund it and how important it is versus, you know, medicine and food and shelter, I mean, that's always an ongoing debate. But the number of different ways in which the arts contribute to society, and the example from the WPA in the 1930s when we were in crisis and the government said, we need artists. We need artists to inspire people and give them hope and keep spirits lifted when we have such hard work to do as a country. We need artists to document what we're going through as a nation. And we need to remember that by including artists at the table, these are some of our most creative thinkers. And sometimes the way out of a recession requires some creative thinking. And so we have that example of reminding them. But the other thing that, and this goes as much to the state and local governments as anything else, is I hear a lot of debates about whether we can afford to support the arts when times are tough economically. And it kind of makes me crazy, because the governments are not supporting the arts, we're supporting the government. The revenue that is generated by nonprofit arts organizations here across the state dwarfs the amount of economic support that comes back to us, and we need to like fight that fallacy. The arts are supporting everything else. It's not a question of whether we pay for Overture Center or the roads. Overture Center is helping pay for the roads. So if you can help spread that message. my work here a little bit. Very worth it.
I was wondering how you determine the themes for the coming season.
Oh, that's a great question. It was about how we pick the themes for our season. So to be honest, we pick the plays first, and then we kind of go, there's a cool theme there. So for example, this season is our coming home season. And we did the play 4,000 Miles this past fall about the Jewish socialist Bubba, whose grandson shows up to visit her in New York. That was a very personal play for me. But it was about this young man coming home to his family and learning how to process some trauma that he's experienced. The play that we are currently running that closes this afternoon, Outside Mullingar, very much about home and connection with the land, with your family. And this next play that we have coming up this spring, Learning to Stay, which is a world premiere of our first commissioned play. That one's set here in Madison, and I encourage you all to check this one out because I do think it really takes our commitment to serving the community to a new level. It's an adaptation by Jim DeVita of a novel by Aaron Solello, who lives here in Madison, and it's about it's a fictional story, but it's about a young couple where the husband has returned from his second tour in Iraq as a soldier and is coping with reentry and PTSD, and really tells the story from the point of view of his wife, which I really love because I think it's a great opportunity to provide empathy and understanding and for us to have a way in to that experience, whether or not we have members of the military in our own families. So we're going to be doing an enormous amount of outreach programming and work with the VA and the Veterans Museum around that. But we picked those plays and then we looked at them and we said, what's the common thread? I can tell you next season's theme is what's next. I hope that's enticing. And I can tell you that the plays we're doing, because we picked our plays and said, wow, all of these plays are really looking at the future. And interestingly, one play sort of from the point of view of an individual facing their future, and one is a little more about a community trying to decide what the future holds, and one is a little more looking at society and what the future holds for us as a society. So. We just felt that we're going to get stronger seasons and pick better plays if we just look for the plays we fall in love with that we think have a lot to say. And then sort of see, oh, why are we drawn to this? Oh, well, here's this topic that's kind of connecting them, so.
Yeah. Can you talk about how you thought the forward theater model could work in any type of community? And you were very focused on Wisconsin. How are you going about, or are you even, getting that message out to other theater communities?
Right.
I'm not in the theater, but my sister and her husband have a small theater company in Washington.
Oh, excellent.
Right, so it's supported by their community around it because they're trying to create an arts district for the community.
Well done.
But having a successful model, I think, would help a lot of those small organizations. So is there a way that you talk about hiring consultants?
Right.
is there a way that you can reach out, or how other startup theaters can reach out to you?
So in terms of what we're doing right now, honestly, not a lot. I mean, like I said, I think that we've just been really focused on serving the community. That's been our number one mission. We certainly have had some companies who have come across our work, whether it's because we came up in a Google search of something, or because they worked with an artist who had done some work with us who was talking about. So we've had people, you know, email us and say, can we see your bylaws? Because that sounds really amazing. But we haven't really done anything yet to promote that on a broader scale. I do think that there are some things happening in the next year or two that may start to get a little more attention. For example, American Theater Magazine, which is the main publication nationally for what's happening in American theater, ironically. They're actually going to be including our project on Learning to Stay in some covers that they're doing on theater for veterans. So that may draw a little attention. I think as we grow, as we approach, we're in season 8 right now, and so we're doing a lot of thinking about season 10 and our goals. And we've talked within the company about growing into our full potential and what are the things that we would like to do a little bit more of or a little bit better. As we sort of grow into that maturity, we'll have opportunities to spread our staff capacity a little more broadly. And I think that looking for ways to, I don't know, write up what we've done and share that is kind of in the backs of all of our minds. But right now, we're really do the work, serve Madison. That's where we've had our focus so far. But you can all feel free to have people email us and ask how we do it, what we do.
We've been out of town and we didn't get to see the boys, but we have some friends who husband fell asleep during the performance.
I talked to them.
And they got tickets again because she was determined.
I know they were there. I think they were there Friday night. I was talking with them. And he was like, oh, I'm staying awake. She loved it so much. Yeah. And she was excited. She's like, I've never come to see a show a second time, but I'm really excited to see this one. So that's great.
I thought I would share a real brief story. I think the impact that Jim's mom, my wife, had was enormous. She had a real passion for music and theater. And on one occasion, this is one of my favorite stories, we were taken in and went to New York to see his first Broadway musical, which was two cans.
A little louder.
I'll repeat it. Musical. And Andrew was very appropriate to plot it all the time. We were heading home in a cab afterwards, and my wife Liesl was explaining that she'd seen her first show when she was a little girl, and her Andrew was taking her to see Peter Pan musical with Gary Martin. And Andrew said, was it black and white?
My dad was sharing one of our favorite family stories that Mom and Dad took my cousin Andrew to see his first Broadway musical, Seussical, I believe it was, and in the cab on the way back to their apartment, my mom was sharing that her Aunt Ruth took her to her first Broadway musical, Peter Pan, with Mary Martin, and Andrew said, was it in black and white? Passion for theater goes back a couple of generations. Yeah.
Since you brought up movies, I wanted to share I too have only worked in nonprofits. I'm in my seventh now. But my first one, was the Center for Public Representation, where your mother was the fiscal manager.
Yep.
She was one of those nauseating Jewish women who just bragged about her children. But I was with your mom the day we got the news that Liesl Blockstein was killed in the car accident. And so I find it incredibly poignant that you're here today. And it was your mom and I who helped plan some of the reps, recognition of Liesl there. But, we're a small town. Your mom was Jewish, I was Jewish, Liesl was Jewish. And our executive director was Jewish, too, was out of town that semester on a sabbatical. And it was up to your mom and me to plan this. And I think how happy your mom would be to know that you're here.
Thank you for sharing that. I know I wasn't going to get out of this without crying at some point, so thank you. I didn't know that. Yeah, I'm kind of actually glad I didn't know that before. I would have probably been too emotional to lose. Yeah, exactly.
Yes. You have a favorite play that you've done only in the past 8 years?
Oh, I have a favorite play.
Or one that you were like so emotional about or tied to that you wish or you hope that you'll be able to do it again.
Oh, that's great. So the question is if I have a favorite production at Forward that I would want to do again or... Can I have three?
You have 3 wishes.
Thank you. I think the one I would most want to just see again is Farnsworth Invention. That was such a huge entertaining, I don't know if anyone saw that one. That was just a huge production for us and so much fun and such great storytelling. And if I could just sort of go back in time and watch it one more time, that's that one. I think the one that touched me the most, that I felt the strongest emotional connection with, was Silent Sky last season. That one, sort of the art of creating that was sort of the most fulfilling for me. And the one I'm most tempted to do again, or let's say to reinvestigate maybe a couple years from now, is 44 plays for 44 presidents. I think we might be able to do something with that in a couple of years. That might be useful in some way. So,
yeah. So, on the flip side of that, there's a play that many of us didn't know what to make of. You know which one it
is. I do.
And that's the one about Mr. Burns.
Yeah.
I'm one of the people that actually liked it. I liked the first half.
Yeah.
The second half, I was just lost.
Yeah.
And I think all the way through, if you were a Simpson fan, familiar with it, you'd probably get a little bit more out of it. But can you just tell us what it was about?
Sure, I would love to. You are not alone. There is no question that we pushed the envelope with that production.
What was the production?
Mr. Burns, a post-electric play that we did last spring. And we knew going in that it was going to push the envelope. And one of the reasons I'm so grateful every day to work in Madison is that the audience kept saying, push us, try something new. We're like, oh, okay. Here's something we really, really love. What do you think? And it's interesting because we definitely had some folks who hated it. We had some folks who were like, okay, I didn't hate it. That was not my cup of tea, you know, but we still like you. We'll come back. And we also had, we sold more tickets to that play than anything we've ever done. And brought in, I think, about 500 people who'd never seen a show at Forward bought tickets to that show. Mostly young people, and not young like students, I'm talking like 30s or 40s, which is exactly where we need to build the next generation. So really, it was interesting because it was in many ways our most successful production, and for other people, it was really complicated, and its storytelling framework was incredibly unique and I will say, though, I don't think whether you knew The Simpsons or not makes any difference to whether you enjoyed it or not, because I've had people who knew literally nothing about The Simpsons who said this was my favorite play ever, and folks who loved it who didn't get it. So I think that didn't sort of matter one way or the other. But I fell in love with it when I read it and was terrified by it in a way, because I thought that it really, really forced us to look at this huge, big picture of storytelling and what it means to us as a civilization. And I thought that the way the playwright went at that, for those who didn't see it, it took place in three acts. And the first act takes place in the near future. And let me also say, I would not want to be producing it right now, because I think that first act would scare the living daylights out of me, given the world we are now in that we weren't a year ago. Takes place in the near future, and it posits that the electrical grid has failed and nuclear power plants have melted down all over the country, and a band of survivors is kind of walking around the country trying to find their loved ones. And they are passing the evening around a campfire, doing what we all do, you know, telling stories to pass the night and to build community, and they choose in that particular time to try to remember a particular episode of The Simpsons that it impacted them. And the second act takes place 7 years later, and these same characters have, you know, society is kind of trying to rebuild, but there's still no power, and there's not really civilization anymore, and they're performing episodes, live action episodes of The Simpsons to try to entertain people and kind of get them through it. By the third act, it's 75 years later, and this has become our new mythology. And they've tied these images of the nuclear fallout and how that impacted with ecological concerns and a story of survival, and they've made a new mythology out of it. And so it was a really challenging piece and huge for us, just to accomplish it and get it up on stage. And we knew that it would be not divisive, but polarizing, that people would probably either love it or hate it. We went out on a limb, and it definitely impacted a lot of people, so we're really proud of that. I think that you will in the future at some point see us do an occasional production that challenges us that much, and not all the time. And when we fall in love with it, when we feel like the message that it has is really worth it. But thank you for sharing that. I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
I just wanted to add to that that I thought of all the plays I've seen you guys do, that one supported your mission, I think, more than many others, because it really is about how does storytelling impact us as a society, and it made me think about the work you do outside that play.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate that.
Have you been able to track how many of the younger demographic return this year?
Yes. I don't have that number at the top of my head, but I know that our communications director, Scott Hayden, who some of you may have communicated with, we have this fabulous new database that allows us to actually say, oh, who are those 500 people, and did they buy a ticket to 4,000 miles, and can we invite them to come and see the next show? So we did that. Actually, we had another 400 people that came to see the flick who were new to Forward as well. So, yes, we're following them and trying to entice them to come back.
I just want to thank you for coming. It was just a wonderful presentation. We are so lucky that you moved back to the sound. Everyone to become a subscriber to Forward. We love your shows. But Silent Sky was amazing, and I never knew about Henrietta Leavitt. And because of you, we got both of our granddaughters and the older one with the telescope. She went last summer to a science camp, and the update is she's going again this year. Uh-huh. And it's and this is the power of the of theater and the arts. And so it's because of you. And thank you.
Oh. Surveying our audience to see what people would like to see us remount. We haven't, and it's partly because we've been doing with just three plays a season, and with our focus on doing contemporary work, we've never considered remounting anything that we've done. That might change in the future. We have goals to add a fourth production. And so that might give us room. Do you have a request? As I said earlier, our mission is to employ local theater professionals. We happen to be very fortunate to live 45 minutes away from a community of some pretty world-class theater professionals. We hire people from there, we hire people from Milwaukee, we hire people from Madison. That's what we do. But it's been wonderful to see those core company members, and frankly, a lot of their designers and technicians, start to see Forward as their other home. And a chance to do a very different kind of work for what they're doing there. It's just a no-brainer. I mean, I've got these great artists, they live nearby. I don't have to fly them in or house them or anything. The audience already knows them and loves them, but gets a chance to see them doing something that they have not seen them do before. I know that I've gotten a lot of feedback from, David Frank when he was still in charge of ABT and now Brenda, that it's been a huge boon ABT because so many of their artists now live in Spring Green, and a lot of them have young children, and now they can work in the off season without having to leave town, and then that's made life easier. So it's just one of those virtuous cycles where we all do well when we all do well. For me, just as an audience member who loves to go up there and see things, I love to go, all right, Sarah Day, you're going to come do something that is nothing like what you're doing up the hill there, and it's just fun.
And the current performance as well.
Yes, David Daniel and the current shows. Two more questions. Okay.
Do you have any pressures in the middle of your
space? The question is whether we have any pressure to move into a bigger space, and would we want to? No pressure other than the fact that there are not as many. Not enough seats for everybody. Again, these are good problems to have. I love the Playhouse so much. I love how intimate it is that I can still fit 325 people in there and have it feel like an intimate evening.
evening. That's the kind of theater I most like to create, so I don't know if I would enjoy as much creating work in the Capitol Theater, as beautiful as it is. It would be nice to have a little more capacity to fit more people in, but I think we would lose something really important. As long as we're able to get in enough people that we can pay our bills, pay our artists a living wage, you know, wind up in the black so that we don't have to worry that a snowstorm might take us out completely. I don't see us leaving the playhouse. It feels like home. There's that word again. It feels like home. And I think that level of intimacy is so valuable. One more. Oh, you have another question.
Are you going to do any more of those evening of virtual?
Oh, are you thinking about the Four Seasons?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's the Four Seasons, which is a different company from ours, but they do those great. Yeah, the Four Seasons Theater. They do those great American Songbook evenings. It's a lot of, I mean, Sarah Marty runs that. She's worked with us in the past, so it's, you know, Four Seasons Forward. It's very, all these fabulous woman-led theater companies and working in Madison. But I'm sure she'll be doing more of those. Those are great. I will let her know.
You only do three,
and that'll be my last comment. So in addition to our three main stage productions, we do a program to support new work and the development. I mean, if we're going to be a home for theater artists, we have to support playwrights as well as everybody else. So we have two different programs that we do in alternate years. We do our Wisconsin Rights New Play Festival, where we do a weekend of three nights, stage readings of three different full-length plays by Wisconsin playwrights. And that'll be coming up in September. So season 9 has the Wisconsin Rights Festival. And then in alternate years, we do monologue festivals where we set a theme and we say, hey, playwrights, or really anyone who ever wanted to write a monologue, here's the theme. So, you know, we've done Someone's Gotta Do It about jobs. We've done Soul Food. We've done The Love That Changed My Life. We've done banned books. And people submit monologues. We got 300 submissions for the last festival, which we juried down to 12 pieces. And then we perform it for a weekend, and it's 12 different local actors and 12 different local directors, 12 different playwrights, all these short little 10-minute and under pieces on this theme, and they're really fun. And while the exact focus of the next one, which will happen in our 10th season, is not yet finalized, I can tell you that, just because I'm really jazzed about this right now, I had one of our volunteers pointed out to me that in 1919, Wisconsin was the first state to ratify the 19th Amendment, giving women the right to vote. 2019 is the 100th anniversary of that, which is also during our 10th anniversary season. I felt pretty inspired by that. I don't know what the focus will be, I don't know, but to me, I think there's something very positive and, pardon the pun, forward thinking about our progressive history in this state. And I think remembering and celebrating that and thinking about how that leads us into the future could be a pretty great subject matter for a monologue festival. So watch this space, there'll be more information later, but that's a sneak peek for the morning. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here today. Thank you for being such a generous group to welcome Jennifer Uphoff Gray to our community. There, I want to offer a brief Hebrew lesson. It's as easy. We have the Book of Psalms. In the Book of Psalms, there are 150 different psalms, 150 different songs, and a number of them start off with a superscript, and it's in Hebrew, Laminat Seach. And it's somewhat hard to translate that word, Laminat Seach. But I want to offer three possibilities. The scholars of our people say that Laminat Seach is an ode, it is a dedication to the conductor. So we offer this to one of the major conductors in our town, a conductor of theater, so we thank you for that. Another meaning of Laminat Seach could be something about victory, and something about the word Nitzachon in Hebrew means victory, and so something that has been successful. And we know that Forward Theater continues. We hope that Forward Theater continues its success. And another meaning of that word, or another meaning that's contained in that word, is netzach, which is a certain sense of eternality. And so we hope that whether Forward Theater goes on forever, which would be a wonderful thing, we know that its spirit will go on forever, as you have imbued us with the spirit of this morning. So, Jennifer, thank you very much. And again, thank you all for coming this morning. Have a wonderful afternoon.